Help me to pretend that I'm not alone. You think I know better by now, but I still drink until you're next to me again, baby. Yeah. And I still think that in the morning I might wake up next to you.
Let's go. phone. Help me to pretend that I'm not alone. And you think I'd know better by now. Hello, everybody, and welcome to Laguna Seca Raceway for the Season 16 GT3 World Challenge Trophy. And we are in for an incredible race with some of the best drivers in Pitskill that I owe. I am joined once again by Harrison Deal. You can see him on your screen there, ladies and gentlemen. And what round is it, Harrison?
It is round 9 of 10. And also the first round, which we will start to see the dropped points come into effect. So there is a lot on the line for these drivers. This is the time now where I think the standings are going to get all mixed up. So, yeah, the drivers are going to be pushing as hard as they can today to make these one of the good results.
Yes, that's right. The stakes are high out here on Laguna Seca, and Manuel Benz is currently leading the Pro Class with 329 points. Jerome and Ben Averod are right behind him, however. And as you said, the drop standings are going to start to come into effect. So what we see on screen might not be the same as next week, because those points will move and shake. Now, in the Silver Class, the Hare is leading with David Cox in second and Dieter Santon in third. Let's get those rest of the standings up on the screen for you. So on the left-hand side there, you can see Manuel Benz with 329 points. And you might go, well, that's a big difference. But not really, because that's his technical maximum points he can have at the moment, unless he gets first here. Which Laguna Seca, he moaned about this track since the championship started, that it's not the best track for the Ferrari. So we'll find out what's going to happen at Laguna Seca in the pros. But the Silvers, they've been battling it out all season currently, haven't they, Harrison? And they have been very, very close. And currently, without the drop standings even coming into effect, there's 17 points separating first and second, and then not too many separating third and fourth, you can see there, with, well, the rest of the grid kind of right next to him as well. So it's going to be very, very tight up and down the grid. And I reckon these drivers are ready to push themselves and their cars to the limit, aren't they, Harrison?
Yes, they definitely are. I mean, we are here at one of the most iconic tracks, I think, in the world, especially ACC. It is, it's definitely known for its twists and turns, one twist in particular. So yeah, it's going to be a thrilling race, and I just can't wait to see what is going to happen this week.
Yes, one twist which we'll hopefully see everyone get through every single lap completely fine.
Yes, fingers crossed.
Corpium. Yeah, we'll go for Corpium on that one. Well, I think the drivers are currently out there right now practicing. There's still 5 minutes left on that free practice. So let's see what they're all getting up to out there on the track as it stands. There you go. You can see Reina Schull in the Honda. Should be very, very quick here. And you can't vote for the driver of the day just yet. You can vote for that a little later on, though. Emmanuel Benz currently the fastest out on the practice track at the moment. Ben Averod in second in the Averon Strident Forever. Obviously, free practice pace not exactly indicative of how the race is going to go for all these drivers. But you know, I'm expecting this silver grid to be very shook up after this race, at least for one reason, if not another.
Definitely. We've got Laguna Seca this week, which I think is a bit like Marmite for these drivers. I think some are either going to love it or some are going to not love it as much. I won't say hate it, but not love it as much. And then obviously next week we do head over to the lovely track that is Kyalami, which I think a lot of people do favour, and a lot of people have got a lot of experience on. So, yeah, today will be an interesting one. It's kind of, as I say, it's kind of the Marmite track. So I think whatever we do predict will probably be flipped on its head. I mean, yes. We know for a fact Manuel Benz doesn't like the track, so we can, but he is still up there in P1.
That's very true. I mean, you've got to... It's a hard track to overtake on. I think that's the issue. It's not great for quote unquote racing, but it will produce a very close race. I hope, because it's not a track that you can overtake on. So being patient and picking your overtakes is going to be absolutely critical. Right? I mean, we're already seeing 121s coming in from Manuel Benz, so the qualifying is going to be pretty quick up here. But it'll be interesting to see how some of the cars that aren't too great across a race go. I mean, you know, we got Jag in, Busso GT in his Jag. How's that going to do at Laguna Seca? I don't think I've ever seen a Jag at Laguna Seca, and it's currently 5 seconds off Benz. So I reckon he'll find some time at some point in the qualifying. And yes, as you say, you know, there's not a lot of different cars that are very quick on this track. I reckon the grid's pretty balanced in terms of, you know, the OP carness. But yeah, Cabrera, one of the Hondas. I think there was another one. Ah, yeah, Reina Schull. I knew we had him up earlier. Reina Schull currently in 10th, but at the top of the grid, not many quick Hondas. So it'd be interesting to see what develops from the pace on the top of the grid. You know, Cabrera pretty quick anyways. Will that Honda give him what he needs to close down at the top? You know, you've got Giron in the BMW, maybe not one of the quickest cars around here. Did say he was struggling a little bit to get it right on top pro level pace. But yeah, it should be a fantastic race, shouldn't it, Harrison?
Yeah, I think it's going to be full of lots of battles, lots of... I think we will see quite a few overtakes, to be honest. Even though the track doesn't make it easy, I think we will see quite a lot. Just with how the rest of the races this season have gone, they've been very, very close, and I think we have struggled in the majority of the races to know where to look. So I think today is going to be exactly the same.
Yeah, I mean, whenever I think of Laguna Seca, I think of it being like the Brands Hatch of America, right? you kind of have the drivers just follow each other around for a while, and you get the auto overtake here and there, but a lot of it is close racing. So if anything, it'll be hard for us to pick out a pack to watch, hopefully. I mean, if Benz gets a good run at the start, he could run away at the start, which, you know, he'll be looking to do. Really, if you're looking for a championship win, you don't want to get involved in any fights and you just want to pull away and win it, right? But
yeah,
I reckon all these drivers will be looking to make sure that that does not happen. They will be looking to make sure that Benz does not run away at the start, does not pick up another first place, and does not, you know, win the championship before it's even over. And then if we look down the silvers, you know, there's a lot of drives that have been swapping first place up there. I don't think one driver has won first place in every single race. No. So, Fehair, who's currently leading that championship, who's currently in 10th right now, new livery for him. I like sand. It gets everywhere, apparently. you know, he's only got 2 wins in silver class. So he's by no means won it. David Cox has 1 win and he's in 2nd. And Dieter Santon has a lot of a couple of 2nd place finishes and 3rd place finishes. So, you know, Chris Wright has a win at Misano. So he still has the ability to possibly take it on to the back of Fehair. But really, you know, the grid for silvers is blown wide open. Anyone could claim a win here and get themselves some good points.
Yeah, they could. I mean, all you have to do is head over to pitskill.io, head over to the league, and under the standings tab, I mean, you can see P10, 11, and 12 all separated by 1 point, and 2 people actually join. So those guys, you know, if one can finish 1 or 2 places above the other, they're going to start shooting up this table quite quickly. And as you say, even at the top of the grid, there's not that massive of a gap, which I think is why we've seen the silvers pushing so hard this season, because the skill level has kind of ramped up so much, which is a good thing, of course. Everyone's getting better. And yeah, it's leading to a lot closer racing. So yeah, if there's anyone that's interested in getting involved, the amount these guys practice, you'll need to be on your best game, should we say.
That's it. I mean, even though we do have that that drop round system in place, it does mean that, you know, even at this point, anyone could win it. And week on week, the drivers are practicing harder and harder because they want to pick up the points, and they're noticing that the rest of the pack is also, you know, getting faster and faster. So to be able to pick up those points, you've got to get quicker. So technically, at the start of the championship, it's easier to get those points as long as you keep out the instance. But yeah, as the grid develops, then there's more points on offering, and the drivers are fighting harder and harder to get to them. So yeah, like you said, if you want to take part, practice is required unless you're pretty quick from the get-go anyways. So yeah, it'll be interesting to see what happens next season as well, with the changes that are coming.
Yeah, I was gonna say, speaking of next season, we won't only be moving to season 17. I think that's crazy to say that, actually, is it season 17?
Yeah.
Oh dear, we're gonna be at 20 soon. But yeah, we've also got a lot of changes coming in terms of hosting and the website as a whole. So, you know, we've been listening. We know that a lot of people do struggle with our current process for signing up. We are fully aware. We dislike it ourselves as well. It's not the easiest to follow, but we have a lot of changes coming that should hopefully mean you can sign up and race. What would you say, within 5 minutes?
I'd say it's about 3 clicks.
Yeah.
Three clicks
and a few text boxes, and you'll you can be registered and ready to go. So
it's not even a text box; it's 3 clicks. 3 clicks, race.
Well, you've got a clean profile.
Ah, yeah. No, yeah. I mean, if you're counting in the profile, then it's a few more clicks. But if once you create it, it's 3 clicks done. You don't even have to wait to sync up with SGP anymore. It's magic.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, so we have been listening. We haven't been quiet for no reason. We've been quiet but hard at work, and uh, We talk on everyone's feedback. You know, a lot of people said they want matchmaking. Well, that's built in from the start. So, yeah, as long as there's enough drivers, matchmaking, you know, easy to do. We'll match you up to drivers your pace. So you'll be able to drive with anybody and ensure close racing. You know, pit reps getting a complete overhaul. And by complete, I mean 0% of the code from the original pit rep system is being used in the new one. So the whole thing, apart from what shows on the front end, will get completely, well, already has been completely redeveloped. So yeah, your pit rep safety rating system, brand new, which means that all of that stuff that we've had issues with, you know, all the like being involved in a Blackwood incident and you get a massive deduction and everyone else going, you know, all that kind of stuff, that we've took all that on board. We do listen to, we do listen to our community and we do develop solutions to problems that we know you're having and we know exist in the first place. And yeah, with the brand new version of PitSkill that's coming out on the 6th of April, all being well, for season 17, you know, it's all going under a complete redevelopment because we know the issues that are coming. And we want to ensure that we have the best in class safety rating system out there. So we have taken some inspiration from platforms that do work well, iRacing being one of them. And we've also gone, well, actually, you know, maybe that bit doesn't work well, or that bit kind of, you know, could do with some changes. So we've done that. And yeah, so it'll be interesting to see. But because we still have some legacy data in there, there is some further changes that will be coming up later on as well. And yeah, features that we've had as league organizers, the plan is not just to build, you know, not just to build something that works for us, but also works for everyone. We want PitSkill to become more than a league. We don't want to just be another league. We want to be a platform for everyone to have, you know, matchmaking races, to be able to race in grids that are close to them, as well as, you know, focus on what matters in racing. And that's not just, you know, that's just not just being the fastest and making sure you budge everyone out the way to get yourself into that position. You also have to be safe as well. And that's why the main focus of the license will still be the safety rating system, and that's why it's gone over a major development. Not just that, but we will be able to rank team events. And I'm just looking here, and the next endurance, now I don't want to put too much pressure on us as a team, but the next endurance is on the 8th, and I don't think it's going to be quite ready for that one. But, you know, never say never. Never say never. We might be able to rate that event past its completion. And all of those drivers in the 9 hours of Watkins might be able to improve their pit rep safety rating system, as well as get pit skill rating from that race. So you heard it here first, folks, that you might be able to see results on pit skill from that race. So yeah, get involved with that 9 hours of Watkins. And yeah, we've been hard at work, and the VIP members have been testing it. There's another test coming up on Thursday, so if you're not already a VIP member and you want to see what's coming up, you want to get involved with making PitSkill, you know, a platform for everyone, then get involved, get signed up to become a VIP. It helps support us, helps pay for the service, helps pay for everything that we develop. And, you know, it also helps you get some insider information and get involved in some of the races. Yeah, we had a test of matchmaking the other week, and it went pretty well. Went pretty well. You know, everyone got match made. So, yes, we can confirm that the system does work, and, you know, it's going to be an amazing step forward for the platform, isn't it, Harrison?
It is, yeah. I mean, you got to remember as well, it's not just the racing aspect. I mean, our very popular livery system, I mean, we're at over 1,200 liveries now, which is crazy to think. I mean, when it first, I mean, for those that don't know, Here's a spoiler for everyone. The Pitskill website was originally only meant to be a livery sharing website for the pit crew. And it grew to what it is today. So, yeah, to see the new livery system having over 1,200 liveries as well. I mean, you know, when you do register to these new races, liveries will be automatically synced, fingers crossed, across all the people in your race. So no more, you know, struggling to find the pack that you need to subscribe to. We will still have packs. But mm-hmm. yeah, in terms of the matchmaking races, liveries should auto sync to your PC and you should be able to see them with no effort at all.
Yeah, you'll also still be able to use other people's liveries. So for, you know, for those liveries that out there that you go, oh, well, you know, Johnny uploaded that one and I would have used Johnny's livery because he's let me use his livery. Well, you can still do that. You can still do that. You can still use them in those matchmaking races. You'll still be able to pick them in the livery selector before you enter that race, and you'll be able to use other people's liveries as long as they're in a pack and you're subscribed to it. So that's... So the packs will stay. They'll still stay for leagues. You know, we don't want to remove any features that other leagues do use because it is a livery sharing platform, and that's the idea of it. And it will still stay free. You won't have to pay to use your liveries. You won't have to pay to run them in a race. You won't have to pay to, you know, host a league and put some liveries on your league. You don't have to pay for any of that. We don't, you know, it doesn't cost us that much because we've made that many improvements to it that it doesn't hurt too much. However, you know, storing all the liveries and all that kind of stuff still does cost, so we still do need that that VIP buffer. But, you know, we'll be adding more and more features as we develop the platform for VIPs. So yeah, so if you're a VIP member, you'll get more and more features as the platform matures over 2023. But a lot of it, you know, we're going to be focusing on making sure that drivers get the best in class races that we can provide. But, you know, all of it depends on you as drivers, and we can only build a platform. You guys have to show other drivers just what the platform's capable of. So yeah, we're counting on you guys to, you know, spread the word, get drivers involved, bring them into the races, because, you know, being just involved in a Discord doesn't help us reach any new drivers. And yeah, what we've got to do is bring those new drivers in. So hopefully all you guys watching are like, yeah, fair enough. You can head on over to Pitskill already. We're nearly at 5,000 drivers. Do you know that, Harrison?
We are, yes. We're very, very close. I think we're in the last 100 to 5,000 drivers. So yeah, if you're not signed up on the website, please do. Yeah, we're very close to 5,000. That'll be a brilliant milestone. Will we reach it before we release the new website, though? That's the question. It's a race, isn't it?
Yeah, I mean, who's gonna win? Is it gonna be the 5K driver signups, or is it gonna be Pitskill 2.0? I don't know. It's close.
Yeah,
it is. Close. I mean, you know, if you're saying, I don't know how many drivers join us a week. I could probably figure out the stats if I looked. But you know, in a month, we get something like 300 new drivers a month. I'm just waiting for the graph to show up. And yeah, so. Yeah, it's around about 300, 400 new drivers a month. So at this rate, in 2 weeks, we will have passed easily 5,000 drivers. So yeah, but if you want to, you know, if you want to invite other people to Pitskill, head on over to Pitskill, click your name in the top right, and then head over to the referral program. You can get your code and you'll get some benefits soon, PM. That those referrals will help for. So yeah, definitely one to look out for. You know, if you can't afford VIP, who knows? You know, you might be able to cash in some referrals for that VIP rate, for that VIP coming up later on. You'll also get some other goodies, hopefully, when we start adding them in. So yeah, definitely something to do. Get yourself out there and tell other drivers about us. Because it might have been difficult to sign up, but we can promise you in 2 weeks' time, all that pain will go away.
It will. And speaking of pain going away, Dieter Santom.
Good segue. I like it.
Very, very close to Cabrera, who is currently lapping a 121.9. around Laguna Seca. The Honda, as we know, a fairly strong car here at Laguna. So not too much of a surprise that he's up there in P1. But yeah, the drivers behind, you know, in terms of silver times, they're not too far behind. I would say this is probably one of the wider grids we've seen this season, though. But that could just be because it is Laguna Seca, quite a tricky track.
Yeah, that's definitely, I mean, you know, we're seeing Cabrera do the 121.5. We saw Benz do that in qualifying, but I'm gonna say that that's on full fuel, because looking at his hot lap time, it's a 120.9. So not too much, you know, not too much to gain really for Benz. Possibly, you know, he's got 6 tenths quicker than Cabrera on optimum times. Don't know, but Reese Tattersall, who isn't in the league, managed to do a 120.7 in the Honda. So the Honda definitely quicker than the Ferrari. But maybe Cabrera will be able to get himself in amongst the pros and get some pit skill rating before next season starts. Oh, getting a little bit slider there, though, in the Honda. But it's nice to see a group of Porsches. Group of Porsches. Drew Neville, Sam McCarthy, and Didier Tessanton must have all been sharing tips, the Porsche brethren. And Didier Tessanton currently sat in second. And a look at Dougley in the CDLC Grey Flame Wrap, number 18, in sixth. You know, you've got Martin Riphagen down in 11th, Ike Chew's in 12th, and then, you know, we've got a stack of pros soon starting to leave the qualifying and head on to the track, rather. Yeah, I think they're already lining up. Yeah, Ben Lopard already lining up. Got, Thibaut lining up as well. You see, well, just lining up on the end of the pit lane. Surely that'll cool down the tyres. Yeah, it's a rather interesting part of the qualifying, but
I mean, if you think about it, because of our no overtaking rule, there's actually a benefit to being to being sat at the beginning start of the pits, isn't there? They can't overtake you, so you will be the first car to go around.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, you know, Ben Lopez going to be in the front, and they can overtake until sector 3 on the outlap, I believe. It would help if I read the briefing that was sent out to the teams, wouldn't it? But yes, having a look at it, I believe that they can overtake up until sector 3. Ah, yes, as long as they're not on a hot lap, it's allowed during the outlap and it needs to be done before sector 3. So I do know the rules. That's great, isn't it? But yeah, Ben Lopard getting released there. They are allowed to line up on the on that pit straight, pit exit rather. But they can't go over the line because obviously they could be technically on track then. But yeah, Ben Lopard coming out then. And it looks like Cabrera does qualify top of the silvers for 121.5, 5 tenths quicker than Didier Tessanton. So it'll be interesting to see if that's a Honda. That's from the Honda. Or whether it is from Cabrera. I mean, I remember Cabrera being quite quick last week as well, wasn't he, Harrison? I'm sure you can pull up the stats whilst I'm talking and figure out where he finished.
Yes.
In pit skill 2.0, we'd even be able to tell you where he qualified.
We would. We'd get even more stats. That we get all the data.
Yeah, we get all the data. Website. And yeah, VIPs will get even more data when it's implemented.
And they will. So Cabrera last week finished P1. Yep, he won the race last week.
Yeah, I thought so. Yep.
His first race in the championship as well. Obviously, he joined quite late. So, obviously, he's not competing for the top slots.
No.
You know, it'd be almost impossible to gain that many points. But, yeah, giving it a go. I imagine we'll see him back next season, and this will be essentially his kind of a warm-up, right?
Yeah, that's what I reckon as well. Cabrera probably warming up this season. You know, next season, for everyone out there that wondering when next season starts, it won't start for 4 weeks. Well, 5 weeks technically from now, 19th of April. It won't start until the 26th of April because of the 1.9 patch that's coming from ACC. So you'll have a few weeks to be able to get that pit skill rating up before getting into the championship, but it won't be starting until after that season that April 19th patch. But there will be a season starting for our matchmaking service on the 6th of April. So, you know, you'll be able to still get involved in some races. And a fresh new season coming out on the 6th. And then the GT3 World Challenge will be starting on the 26th of April. So circle it in your calendars, get yourself signed up, get ready, get your pit rep up. You'll still need C-Class pit rep, although it will be pit rep 1.99, we're calling it. That will dictate whether your pit rep is high enough. So make sure you get involved in plenty of races to be able to get that pit rep rating up. And I would recommend you get a lot of clean races in. That's all I would say.
Yes, not to spoil it. but yes, clean races are favourable.
Yeah, if you're barely C-class right now, you're probably not going to be C-class in the new rating system.
Just an
obvious statement that it's a little bit more. It's a little bit more. What's the word?
It's less lenient.
Yes, it's less lenient. We'll go for that. It doesn't require as much manual intervention. Is the key coding requirement of it? It was the key requirement. We want it more automated and less requirements for manual deductions. So. Yes, if you're barely C-class right now, you will not be C-class in Pit School 2.0. So make sure you get involved in plenty of races, you know, all of those daily races that do happen. Getting involved, you know, go and hit some people up on Reddit and be like, you know, anyone able to race in X time and Y or whatever, you know, whatever. Go and ask some people, get them involved in the grids. And possibly you'll be able to get yourself involved in the GT3 World Challenge next season. Just having a look at it, Ben. Ben's first lap was 4 tenths off the mark.
Yeah, not too close. I mean, it was his first lap, but we normally see him shoot straight to the top, don't we? So
yes,
I guess a good indication that the Honda is, I wasn't going to use this word, but OP here. a good track for the Honda. We did see it last season. So, yeah, kind of expected today.
That was a wiggly line coming out. Yeah. Went that fast over the corkscrew and it took off. It was up before he came to the corkscrew, though. But not up as much as he was, but still up. Ben Alvarado, another one who was up before that corkscrew, by the looks of it. A corkscrew messing up with a lot of cars, but I think Ben's is probably not going to get the quickest of laps here. Will get quicker than he was, as you can see when he crosses the line. 1/10 off, but not close enough to Cabrera to take pole position. Hey, Adrian Neville. But yeah, Ben's currently not first. Great to see. No. Great to see in the qualifying. I mean, he's still got 10 minutes to do it, but right now, starting second and not to Jerome Moman. Jerome currently... Where's Jerome? Jerome's currently in 25th place, but I reckon this lap probably going to be one of your quicker ones.
How many silvers do you think we're going to see in the top 10?
That's a good question. And in fact, well, there's currently five so far, right? Four.
Yeah. Five. Still got nine and a half minutes five. To go. But I feel like we'd see more of a split at this point. I mean, a lot of these pros have already got times in and they're not stomping them out yet, are they?
I mean, no.
Yeah, it will be interesting. I mean, Cabrera with the Honda, I imagine at least a Honda in the pros may be able to knock him down. We've got Reyna Schull using the Honda today, car number 7. Potentially, you know, we'd want to see him up there, but I don't think he has qualified in the top 3 so far this season. Someone will correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see if we end up with a silver in P1 to start the race. That will be an interesting start.
Well, are you a believer or are you a doubter? You can vote with your channel points right now. You can go gambling. Do you reckon more than 3 will start in the top 10? There's currently 5. So, you know, 2 would have to drop out. Sam and Fahair would have to drop out for there to be less than 4 in the top 10. Are you a believer or are you a doubter? You can vote with your channel points now. I think you can predict up to like... why does it only say 10? I don't know. But usually you vote more than that. But yes. How many channel points do you want to get? It's up to you. All you got to do is believe or doubt. And right now, looking at it, more drivers are saying yes than no. More people are saying yes than no. You might be able to pick up some easy points here. I mean, all you have to do is get some pros into the top 10. I mean, you know, Rainer shows close, and this lap might be a quick one from him. Knocks himself up in at fourth. So there you go. Ooh. There's another one. Jerome gets himself into fifth. So there's currently four drivers in the top 10. This might be an easy one. There's a few minutes left on that. There's a few minutes left on that prediction. So, you know, whoever votes no might get some easy points here. Depends all on these pro qualifiers and how quick they're going to be. Ben Lopard currently sat in 14th. He won last week. Oh, well, he didn't win. He placed really high last week in the race. So, you know, he's got the opportunity to get himself up that grid. Yeah, just needs to get a good qualifying lap in, you know. Pirello's already in the top 9. So is Thibaut. Fredriksson, who joined us for the first time this season, he's got the opportunity to knock another driver out of the top 10. No, you only need two more drivers into that top 10. And Johnny Ogden hasn't put in a lap yet. So, you know, Johnny Ogden could be another one to knock some drivers out of the top 10. We're going to find out. Rainer Schull looking to improve here. And Ben still isn't first, ladies and gentlemen. 6 minutes to go. Ben's still isn't first.
Yeah, he is very, very close, though. So he has put a good fight in with that Ferrari. Knowing that he isn't very good at this track. I mean, he said this himself. He doesn't enjoy this track very much. So doing pretty well for where I think he would want to be. So Jordan Bailey struggling a little bit to get the BMW round. Currently in 24th position. But over the championship, we've seen him finish quite a bit better than that. He's currently P6 in the standings, very, very close behind. So Jordan Bailey is in the championship right now, fighting up to P4 with Alexander. So hopefully we'll see him qualify higher. Otherwise, this may end up being one of his dropped rounds. The good thing for Jordan is he has only missed one race so far, which was the first one, Misano.
I think he joined after Misano. I think that's why.
Did he?
I think. Okay. I think. Fingers crossed. I think. Off the top of my head. Anyways, yes, hasn't put in a solid lap yet. I mean, it's 2 seconds off the pace. That seems quite a bit for Jordan Bailey, really. Ben's still not been able to qualify top one. That's an interesting predicament. Ben Averod, though, 2 temps up, and he's only just come out of the second sector. Well, he's only just come into the second sector. If he gets a lap together, you know, Ben Averod might be able to get a good lap in here and possibly knock Ben's off second spot. I mean, that prediction's closing, so you want to get some free points or lose some free points. Are you a believer or you're a doubter? Who knows? You know, do you reckon maybe Jordan Bailey's got a lap in him? He needs to find around about 1.5 seconds to knock someone out. Two people need to find enough time to knock Sam McCarthy out. Sam McCarthy's just hoping that he can get into the top 10. Johnny Ogden has put in a lap. 20th place position currently, though. Ben Averod coming around, and let's see what he qualifies. Can he beat Ben's? Not really. Does separate himself from Rainer Schull, though. And we have yet another split qualifying decision. Jerome and Schull matching pace.
They like doing this, don't they, this season? They enjoy getting the exact same time. It's just to confuse us.
I think Jerome might either speed up like 0.01 just to catch up or slow down a little bit, or Schull slows down, because they seem to be matching. I mean, Jerome has been matching a few qualifying times, hasn't he? I can't remember if it's with Schull or not, but he has definitely been matching a few qualifying times. Well, Benz is trying to go faster. I mean, maybe we should have said, can Benz qualify first? Because I think that's more 50-50 than a... Who knows? But Tebow in ninth. Will he knock Sam McCarthy up a step? Well, he's looking to do so. And he's just starting his lap right now. Where's that number 29 car? Ben Averod. Going around the final sector as well. Has gained some time. So has Ben's as he hits the corkscrew. Can he get the corkscrew nailed though? Ooh, nope. Lost a bit of time going through there. Ben Averod comes across the line. Can he knock Ben's off second place? No, but he does close down the gap. 2 tenths away from Ben's now.
Yeah, you saw as Ben's came over the corkscrew then. I feel like the height of the car, the clearance just isn't enough. And it looked like the car was bouncing as it came across the that mound. But yeah.
There we go. Ben's has done it. 121.5. I reckon he had a bit more time in that lap. I'm surprised he gained that much on the third sector. But he has managed to do so. Not by much, though. So Cabrera... Now, if he gets a good run off the line, possibly could pin it on Benz today. And I bet Benz will be like, see, I told you that Honda was overpowered. I mean, a silver class driver is up there with me right now. So, yeah, I can see some choice words.
Yeah, I mean, to be fair, Cabrera did win the first race he joined. So,
that's true.
Potentially, he is a pro driver in disguise. You know, new drivers, we don't know where to place them because there's not a lot of data, so
yeah, that's it.
They will gradually work their way through, so sometimes you see things like this, but
it's kind of like the FIA, right? When you get a few races under your belt and prove your worth, kind of, you know, FIA, you can enter in a silver class, and then when you win some championships you get upgraded, and you'll likely see that as the as obviously new drivers come in and get themselves up the grid. But it looks like no one yet knocking out those Sam McCarthy out of the top 10. So right now, with 40 seconds to go, Manuel Benz putting in a faster lap with 121.4. Does set the gap difference a little bit higher now. You know, no one has yet knocked out enough drivers to give the doubters any points yet. Jordan Bailey and Ben Lopard into the top 8. Sam McCarthy is 2 steps away.
Tebow crosses the line. Split up the three pack of Porsches there. I'm upset with Ben now. I enjoyed seeing that three pack.
The three pack, not an eight pack in Pittsburgh. You get a three pack. Tell you what though, I'm seeing the time start to come in. So maybe these drivers are really pushing it on the final laps. I mean, Jordan Bailey and Tebow both have enough time to knock them both out. So you know, if they want to get the foot down. Jordan Bailey losing a lot of time on that corkscrew seems to be a big, big corner for losing time. I mean, everyone knows that already. And around through the final couple of bends, but Jordan Bailey's in the pits. Can Tebow knock Sam McCarthy into 10th place position? That's what his goal is going to be, at least, as he comes down the corkscrew here. Down the corkscrew he goes. Does manage to keep a bit of time on that car. Down through that sweeping left-hander. Round through the final corner. Didn't dip his wheel in the dirt there. Well, the sand. Sand up in everywhere. The mule taking well to the sand. And across the line, does it knock Sam McCarthy into 10th? Yes, it does.
Yeah, lovely clean final lap there from Tebow. Just knocking out Sam McCarthy and going higher than Ben Lopard by a whole 10th. So, yeah, fantastic lap there from Tebow.
That's true. All right. I mean, we can't do a race without another prediction, though, can we? So we've already had three drivers qualify in the top 10. Let's start a new one. I like predictions. So, Chado, I'm gonna ask you while you're there. What should the prediction be? What can we give points away as we see Manuel Benz lining the grid at the start there with Cabrera in second and Ben Averon in third?
There's a lot to choose from, isn't there?
Yeah, there's a lot of choice on the grid. You know, do you say will a silver finish top five? Or will we say will someone die? How many people will die at the Corkscrew? I mean, that'll be hard to track. Will a driver get more than a 15-second penalty?
Can Cabrera stay in the top five?
Yeah. You know, will... Who knows? Will Moomin actually be able to get on podium? There's a lot of choice out there. And the question is, what do we put the choice on? Who do we place under a spotlight? I think
Cabrera top
five. Yeah, I think. Yeah. I think that's as long as he doesn't do anything too drastic, I think it's pretty much 50-50, right?
Yeah, he's very, very quick. Like I say, won the last race. He did, according to chat, P1 on Saturday as well. Yeah, I reckon he's got a good chance.
Right then, we will put a 10-minute prediction. As long as nothing happens in the first lap to Cabrera, then
good.
Then, you know, there's the points there for everyone. So are you a believer, or are you a doubter? You've got 10 minutes to decide whether you think Cabrera will finish top five or not. What's the question, Harrison?
Can we do a quick livery tour? 40 seconds.
Can we do a quick livery tour? Can we? Well, we can.
Can we? Here we go.
Yeah, magic.
Here we go.
Magic. We've got the minions who are minions looking for bananas. Moomin's not got a custom livery. Boo. They definitely do have one, though. I don't know what the number 7 is. The shawl livery.
Some TV show, perhaps?
I'm not sure.
Not sure.
The 603. They've gone through a lot of livery revisions, the 603 Autosport E1 SimSport car. That's a custom livery as well, you know. The old Porsche, I believe. Ben Lopard livery. The Racing Mule livery. You got a Pit School logo there. Nicely hidden. You got the Pennzoil from the Fredrickson. I believe he's streaming on Twitch. Go follow him. Pit School. You can find him in the Pit School tags. We also have the Thomas Pirello. Fabulous. Way. Hang on. Come back, Tebow.
Off we go.
Off we go.
We've got
a lot
in there anyway.
Yeah. Got a few in there.
So I think, yeah, I mean, all these liveries are on the Pitskill website. So all the liveries you see on stream are uploaded to Pitskill. It's up to the driver whether they want other people to be able to use their liveries. So you'll need to have a look on a per livery basis. But at the very least, you can... the desktop app can sync these so that you can see them in game. So yeah, if you're interested in liveries, you want to see them, yeah, head over to Pitskill.
Yes, and if they're not available publicly, it might be because the user didn't know that you could select it. So just go poke them on Discord if you want to be able to use it. And obviously next season, you'll be able to sign up to a pack and use all that user's liveries if they so wish. Right, Moomin. Currently in fourth. Rainer Schull in fifth in the 59ers. Dieter Santon qualifying at sixth then for E1 SimSport in the silvers. As well as Jude Neville in the LT Racing Chickasay. See, that's why it's a custom livery. Tebow getting the Racing Mules livery there. Oh, that's a different camera. Ben Lopard in the Legis Picon Beer Carsing Team, number 30. Also custom livery. Sam McCarthy. No, that's not a custom livery. That's just an in-game one. Or is it? I don't know. Someone can tell me in chat if you could do that in-game or not. John and Bailey definitely just in the BMW Motorsport there. Fredrickson Motorsport. Artage in the Fredrickson. Fabulous Thomas Pirello. Will it be fabulous today? We'll find out. For her, in the Sandy Ferrari. How fast is it going to be at Laguna Seca, though? Almost blends in like a little...
It does.
Camouflage livery. I wonder if he's hoping no one will see him, not him. Chris Wright in his usual livery. The Sim Whips. The Sukum Quips. Wutke qualifying in 18th. I'll tell you what. Wutke has definitely grown in positions. Unluckily for Bosso, though, he's down at the bottom of the grid.
Oh. Yeah, down at the bottom. I mean, yeah, all the focus is now going to be on the front, though, as we come round the final corner. You ready, Terry?
I'm ready, Harrison. Are you ready for what will be round 9 of 10 of the GT3 World Challenge here at Pitskill.io? The GT3 trophy. Will Benz claim another victory? Will Cabrera finish in the top 5? Well, that's the question we are asking to the chat here. And Manuel Benz gets a good run, managing to defend the inside line a little bit, but Averon already on the back of him as we come into turn one. Cabrera forced the outside. Averon up into second. Moorman looking for a choice place move there onto the inside of Cabrera. Doesn't manage to get it done though. Cabrera slips into third. Moorman in fourth. Ben Averon up to second. Reyna Scholl hot on the heels of this car, but you can see already Dieter Santon looking for a move. And as we ride on board with Reyna Scholl, he looks to close down onto the back of Cabrera. Moorman ahead in third, and Manuel Benz already starting to get a good gap. But anyone that's already chosen for Cabrera to finish in the top 5 might already be out of points.
Yeah, brilliant start there. A few positions swapped and changed as we come up now to the corkscrew, the infamous corner here at Laguna. We see the cars coming through, just a couple of taps, people swapping positions. Oh, we've got one car spun. This is Fredriksson just coming up to the corkscrew. Interesting to see whether he can recover. Dieter Santon now, after going down the corkscrew successfully, is being chased hot on his heels by I can't tell who that is.
Who isn't he getting chased by? That's the real question. Dieter Santon right now in fifth, Scholl in sixth, Lopard in seventh, Jude Neville in eighth. Up past Bailey, he's gone. Bailey looking for the move up the inside though, and Bailey doesn't manage to get it stuck, but Jude Neville giving him the room. This is going to cost him here. This is going to cost him that position, and Thibaut already looking to get it past Pirello. Pirello up in to 10th and closing down onto Jude Neville. What a race we're seeing, Harrison.
Yeah, what a race. Exactly what I expected from Laguna Seca. We're already seeing lots of very, very close battles as we come through now. These corners, the one that we see here, turn 3 of 4, corners that you need to carry a lot of speed through. So we see there the BMW being pressured from behind by Jude Neville in the Porsche. Now, you can see there both managing to carry a similar sort of speed as you see from the rear wing. Now, as we come up to the corkscrew, can Jordan Bailey break late enough to not let Jude Neville pass? It looks like he can, and both getting through the corkscrew successfully.
Yeah, Reyna Scholl looking to see if he can make a move up the inside of Dieter Santon, but doing so has allowed Ben Lopard up in at fifth. Jordan Bailey now down into seventh place position and taking an early pit, actually. This might be an interesting strategy. Dieter Santon also coming in the pits. Not got too much damage from what I can see, though. Jordan Bailey and Dieter Santon into the pits. Alexander also taking a dive into the pits as well as Fredriksson. But we know Fredriksson had that damage. Now, Jude Neville up into 7th. We're seeing a lot of positions change up and down the grid. Thomas Prello up into 8th. Thibaut to 9th. Sam McCarthy to 10th. Maybe they're going for the undercut strategy here, Harrison.
Yeah, I mean, I think they got a lot of traffic. So, yeah, going for the undercut. Very, very early pits, though. This is the earliest I think we've seen people pit for these races. So, interesting to see if this strategy works. We don't know 100%. I see a stop go 30 there for Jordan Bailey. Is that speeding in the pit lanes?
Perhaps? Yeah, it will be. It will be. Stop go 30-second penalty already for Jordan Bailey. Far speeding in the pit lane. Obviously, no stewards' decisions coming out. Not really any major incidents. There's only been the one on Fredriksson, and tell you what, when we get into, you know, round 10 of this championship, it just shows just how close this grid is getting and just how close they'll be able to race. I mean, there was a slight tap going into the corkscrew, but everyone managed to sort themselves out. Just a little nudge. But Chris Wright here looking to close on down to Sam McCarthy. Sam McCarthy, remember, just about scraping himself into that top 10 qualifying. Imagine to stay there for the race as well. Does race on Saturdays as well, I believe. And, you know, it's obviously paying off racing multiple races in the same week.
Yeah, it is. I mean, he's now had the practice of being pressured from behind. You can see there's a pack of four of them, Sam McCarthy, Chris Verhaere, and Doug Lee, all in the silver class, battling it out to try and get into the top 10. So Sam, he's not going to have an easy time here. He's fought well in the qualifying. Can he do the same during the race? He just needs to hold on, just needs to focus on the apexes, and I reckon he might be able to hold on. But there's still 55 minutes to go, so everything to play for.
Yeah, I mean, you know, like you're saying, 55 minutes to go. The pit window's already open. We've seen drivers going early. I mean, that could work out well because they'll be lapping on their own. You won't have to worry about cars in front of them. They can, if they know they can do hot lap pace, you know, they can just put the foot down and maybe get away with some clean air. I mean, is it going to work out well when it comes to the end of the race when drivers are trying to... they're also going to be in that pit strategy and have empty room as well. Who knows? You know, I can't quite tell if that's the best strategy to go for, but we'll find out, I suppose, when we get on through the race. It's going to be one of those. We're going to have to watch and find out. Doug Lee trying to get past Verhaere, but Verhaere putting up the sand wall right now. He really cannot find a way past Verhaere.
No, he can't. I mean, it is difficult on this track, so you really need to be confident in a corner and you really need to try and capitalize on mistakes in order to get past here. So, yeah, Doug Lee, not going to have an easy time here. Be interesting to see if he can make it by a little bit far behind, coming down into turn one there. But
it looks like Jude Neville will be in there, but get a position past Rayner Scholl. Oh, yeah, Rayner Scholl just getting that line a little bit wrong. Backs out of trying to defend the inside line. Jude Neville getting himself past Rayner Scholl. Rayner Scholl didn't want to lose any pit rep in that move, did he? Didn't want to lose any sort of... He's seen the new rating system or something, and he's gone, yep, I'm not having any of that. I am just there. I am taking the avoiding action, which, to be fair, is what we like to see. Because two drivers cause an incident, and if one driver can avoid it, they might as well, right? As we can see, a 10-second penalty come in for car two, or a collision with car seven. Now, that will be Rayner Scholl onto... I think this is... actually, no, car two... Oh,
it's just gone
out. It's that little... That little nudge. Let's find out if we can get a better angle of that. I don't think it was here. They had two sort of contacts. I'm trying to figure out which one it's for. I think it's for this one. Yeah, it's for missing that breaking point there. And just that little nudge. Just that little nudge.
Mm. I think that the outcome looks like, yeah, managing to keep it on successfully. That could have ended a lot worse there.
Yes. Could have ended all sorts of sideways. Chris Wright into the pits as well as Fredriksson into the pits again. Did he not satisfy the pit requirement the first time he came in?
Interesting.
I wonder if he didn't put fuel in his car when he pitted. He just did damage.
See, this is where drivers need to capitalize on these sort of mistakes. You know, if drivers are making mistakes like that and you're not capitalizing on it, you're missing out on a lot of valuable points here.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, we've seen Johnny Ogden trying to get his way around through past and up the inside of Jed, not being able to do it before the corkscrew, not trying to do it too well on the corkscrew. Might get a better exit out of the corkscrew, however, though. And on to the back of the number four. Jair's running my lumber. I'm going to have words. up to the right-hand side. And Johnny Ogden really taking the race to Jair Axlin this race. Jair putting up a good defense. Jair, actually. I think it's Gear. But anyways, the number four really putting up a good defense there. It looks like a driver is going for car 38 for a collision with car 92. Oh, don't think it was that. No, it was that.
Oh,
that explains why Fredriksson was sideways before. They're going to the right, it's going to the left here to defend that inside line going into the corkscrew, and a contact as they were coming over there. So that does explain why he was in the pits for so long.
Yeah, interesting. Manuel Benz, even though he says he doesn't like this track, is already 3 seconds ahead with the fastest lap. So I think he's been telling us porcupines, Terry.
I mean, yeah, he said he didn't like the balance. But, you know, there's no really... I mean, Cabrera's quick, but not... Not Manuel Benz level quick by the looks of it. You know, Cabrera in the Honda was 5 tenths away at qualifying. Best lap is around about the same, 6 tenths away right now. So, you know, even though he is in the Honda, it is a really quick car and he is a really quick driver, not as quick as Manuel Benz at the moment. Yeah, Ben's putting in a 2-tenth a lap quicker lap than Ben Averod. And moving, it's interesting to see Ben Averod actually that close to Ben's in terms of best lap pace, as well as Moomin. Moomin not being able to get it past Averod right now at the moment. But yeah, nice, interesting spread of lap times there. Looks like Pirello has found a way past Shoulder. Let's see if we can find out what happened there. It only just happened. He is sure. Does he just at that curb? The curb on the inside at Laguna, causing the position swap.
There we go. Yeah, it's the mistakes, isn't it, that are allowing these drivers to get through. So.
Yeah, and it looks like Johnny Ogden being a little slow on the exit there, allowing Roy Weller past. Does manage to close down the gap back to the back of him, however. But yeah, Johnny Ogden is slowly slipping away from Roy Weller, and Roy Weller up into 14th place right now.
Yeah, Roy Weller will be happy with that. He's had a tough season so far.
Yes.
A few of his races ending up in a few spins and contacts. So yeah, he will be happy with getting the overtakes that he can get and driving through. Yeah.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
Does stream on YouTube as well. It won't show on the website, but yeah, if you do come across it, he does stream his POV as well.
Yeah, it's in Discord in the Patreon driver content section. So you wanna go? No, it isn't there. Huh, where is it?
Is it not posted it?
I know he's posted it somewhere. It might be in your content. Yeah, it's in your content instead of the Patreon channel. You can post it in both, but yeah, he's chosen to post it in your content. So yeah, if you wanna go check out Roy Weller. I think he races in VR as well, so yeah.
It does.
If you're interested in some VR content, you can go and check out Roy Weller on the YouTubes. And yeah, check out, I think he races on the Saturday as well, so, you know, two races for the price of one. Right, Jude Neville looking for a race on the back of Ben Lopard. Can he find a move in the Porsche? The number 5 Porsche right now on the back of Ben Lopard. Ben Lopard are managing to hold on pretty well right now, though.
Yeah, Ben Lopard is no newbie to feeling the pressure, so Jude Neville will have a tough time getting past, especially because these guys are fighting for the top 5 positions. So yeah, Ben Lopard will not make it easy. Ben Lopard doesn't make many mistakes, not that we see anyway. So yeah, I'm not expecting him to slip up anytime soon. So Jude's really going to need to keep the pressure on here. And someone who is keeping the pressure on, Doug Lee, still on Jair, trying to get past the sandbank man himself. looking on the inside line, looks like Jair not getting the best run through. Not getting the best run through. So Doug managing to stay on the back, but Doug just not managing to capitalize as much to get it past. So still going to be stuck with Fahair as we come through these subsequent corners.
Yeah, Fahair currently holding on to 11th place right now, just about. I mean, right, he says he likes the sand because it gets everywhere. The question is it getting him into a position he wants to be right now? That's the real question. Is it going to get him where he wants to be? Because he's currently in 11th place, you know? Holding out the silver championship right now, but 3 drivers are ahead of him, so needs to get past Sam McCarthy ahead, needs to get his foot down, needs to close the gap to that Porsche ahead, and Doug Lee is going to be with him every step of the way so far by the looks of it. But Jude Neville being held up by Ben Lopard is allowing Thomas Pirello from the other side of the Regis Pecan Beer Coursing team to close it down to the back of Jude Neville. So yeah, the racing is heating up, I would say, at Laguna Seca.
Yeah, I mean, you look at the track map and Thomas Prello here, you can see behind and in front, the cars are not too far behind. With Jude Neville having to battle Ben Lopard, like you say, Thomas Prello is probably going to get involved here. If he just has a couple of good corners, I mean, you can see he's almost already on the back. And I mean, even coming behind that, Rainer Schull may be able to catch up here as well. We might end up seeing a 5 or 6 car battle in the next couple of laps.
Yeah, this is the question of, can Ben Lopard keep his cool under the heat at Laguna Seca? I mean, apparently, you know, he's in 5th place position. Ooh, what a big move there from Thomas Prello. He was having none of that. And Jude Neville going, yeah, I don't want the contact. You've already got it. There's no point me even trying to block that. I'm going to let that one by. Oh, and Roy Weller in the sand. Let's find out what happened to Roy Weller. I think he's probably just took a curb a bit too much by the looks of it. That inside curb. Ah, yes, just moving him towards the outside a little bit. Doesn't manage to keep it out of the wall. We'll have a slight bump in his bumper, but hopefully not bruised him too much. Ike Chew's 6 tenths ahead, so he can still gain back a position if his car isn't too unsettled by that damage.
Yes. Jude Neville managing to keep it with Thomas Prello, managing to keep it within 5 tenths. Rainer Schull coming up behind as well. Just going back to Thomas Prello's move, it was a fantastic move. I was surprised he managed to get it stopped in time when I saw him coming. But yeah, fantastic effort on the brakes there. Able to get it by. I wonder whether we'll see him try and do the same thing with Ben Lopard. It looks a little bit too far behind this lap. But yeah, potentially if he gains a bit of time here. Oh, Ben Lopard going wide, actually. Thomas Prello's going to eat that up. And Ben Lopard losing out 2 positions, both to Thomas Prello and Jude Neville. That one mistake has cost him 2 positions, and he's now being pressured from behind by Rainer Schull. So, yeah, Thomas Prello not needing to do any late braking there, just having an easy time getting by.
Yeah, Rainer Schull's going to be very happy with that, because now he's just sitting that pack claws down. I mean, now, Ben Lopard's basically just hopped back to 2 places on the track in 1 lap, basically. He's hopped past Jude Neville, and Thomas Prello's got by as well, so he's just displaced him and filled that gap between Rainer Schull and Jude Neville. But you can see there, Tebow in the background wanting a bit of this action. And Ben Lopard, you know, we say he's missed the consistency, but he's starting to come apart.
Yeah, he was feeling that pressure after a couple of laps, and that pressure's not going to go away. So hopefully Ben Lopard can cool down, keep it on track now and not lose any more positions. But we may see Rainer Schull able to gain another position if Ben Lopard does make another mistake.
Yeah, that's it. All we're waiting for now is whether Jude Neville can close down that gap back onto Thomas Prello. I mean, getting close as we come to this corkscrew. You know, we've seen a move coming from I don't think we're going to see it from Jude Neville. I don't think he wants to go for the risky really late break into the corkscrew. But I mean, you know, that's high risk, high reward. And if you know you can stop the car where you can stop the car, then you know it might be worth going for. And it obviously worked out for Thomas Prello, and it Jude Neville did have to avoid it, yes, but it's a case of it takes 2 to tango, right?
It does. If the car's on your inside, you've got to leave the room. So if you put your car there, you're essentially giving yourself that line. So yeah, just fantastic racing from them. I mean, Laguna Seca is one of those tracks, when you talk about braking, where I would likely want a button mapped to be able to change my brake bias just for the corkscrew. You know, the braking at the corkscrew is going to be completely different to the braking elsewhere around the track. So, yeah, I imagine some of these drivers will be even going down to that nitty gritty level of as they're coming up to the corkscrew, adjusting the brake bias so they can get it stopped earlier and tighter into there.
Yeah, nice Woodcourt and yeah, Santon going back for a little fight. It looks like Nige was just a little bit slower out of the final corner. And Dieter Santon being able to get a position. You've got to remember, Dieter Santon, one of the earlier pitters, has got a 10-second penalty on his back. However, he's been able to drive around, you know, on his own, so to say, for the last little while. Hasn't had to deal with any of this impact fighting that we're seeing from the top of the grid.
Yeah, had a fairly quiet time up to now. Yeah, nice bit of open track. I mean, someone who doesn't have a lot of open track, though, is this battle here. A little bit of a gap starting to appear in front of Ben Lopard. You see Reina Shaw there looking on the outside. Ben Lopard just letting him know, you know, nope, not going to make this easy for you. So Reina Shaw having to keep it in behind. But yeah, Ben Lopard having this battle with Reina Shaw is giving Jude Neville and Thomas Prello the breathing space they need to make this gap grow and potentially run away. Yeah, so Ben Lopard may not be able to catch back up and regain the positions that he lost.
That's it. I mean, you know, Ben Lopard's got to defend away from Reina Shaw. It's not really a question of can I just hot lap away, and it doesn't seem to be like that because Reina Shaw is pressuring Ben Lopard's line. So if he takes the faster line, which, you know, might not be the defensive line, then Reina Shaw's just going to say, you know what, I'm just going to put my nose up the inside and you can't take that line anymore. You're going to have to give me the room. And yeah, we're seeing here that Ben Lopard's slowing down a little bit and Tebow managed to catch up as well.
Yeah, Tebow now getting involved as well. So we're going to see a three-way battle for the Aston Martin, the Honda and the Lambo. I'd say the Honda being the favourite car, but Ben Lopard having that skill level that he's so far been able to hold them off, and someone that might not be able to hold off Busso is Ike Chews. Martin Riphagen managing to get past Busso, I believe that is.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, Busso not having...
It's already gone. I think he managed to get by on the corkscrew just as they were coming down the corkscrew. The fight between Reina Shaw, Ben Lopard and Tebow still ongoing, however. But Mike Riphagen managing to get past Busso in that Jaguar. So the Jaguar obviously not very strong here at Laguna Seca. But did you notice what position Busso was up to? 19th now, which is seven positions from where he qualified. So able to get that car into a somewhat standing position.
It is. He hasn't pitted though, so
no.
He's going to need to maximize his time on track to make sure he can either counter the undercut or not lose many positions. But I imagine the Jag not being the friendliest at Laguna. I just can't imagine it being.
Yeah, it's a bit of a chunky boy, isn't it? I couldn't imagine trying to wrestle it around Laguna. It's probably one of the least favoured tracks. Considering it's very good on long straights, and I mean, where is Laguna's long straight? That's the real question. Can you call the start finish straight a long straight? I'm not 100% sure you could, but Jude Neville. Ooh, Thomas Prello getting all out of shapes there. This might allow Jude Neville to actually catch up to Thomas Prello, having to back out of a tighter line through that right-hander there. You saw him maybe get a little bit too close to that inside sausage curb. That's the issue here at Laguna. You hit one sausage curb and your race could be over.
Yeah, I mean, we have one driver on the track that does like sand, but I guarantee most of these cars do not. They do not have traction when they go on the sand. So, yeah, you want to be avoiding that sand at all costs. But Jude Neville doing a very good job at keeping the gap within 0.5 to Thomas Prello. Thomas Prello is going to be thinking, what can you do different, you know, to make that gap bigger? Because both these two drivers are running away from Ben Lopard, but Thomas Prello is not running away from Jude Neville right now.
That's exactly it. I mean, you can see Jude Neville right on the back of Thomas Prello. Has been for a few laps. Ben Lopard still has Reina Shaw and Tebow right behind him as well. Tebow is going to be looking to get himself up and close and personal with Reina Shaw. But, you know, Reina Shaw also looking for the move onto the back of Lopard. It looks like Riphagen having a yellow flag, which has allowed for Busso to get by, but I don't know what it was caused by, because was it a sausage curve? Was it a bit too much? It was a bit too much understeer.
Yes, I have done that probably 76 times, that exact move. You just take too much speed into that left-hander, run a little bit wide, and yeah, the sand just takes you away.
Yeah, you really have to get it right. Yeah, Laguna Seca is a very unforgiving track. I've noticed that drivers don't like unforgiving tracks.
I wonder why. It's a mystery, isn't it, Terry?
It seems like a very common occurrence. That, you know, if a track isn't very wide, it's not very highly liked. I mean, apart from Indy. Indy's a very wide track, but no one still likes it.
You know what we need? We need some street circuits. That's what we need.
A bit of Jeddah.
Yeah.
But yeah, a bit of London.
Yeah, a bit of London.
Tell you what, we'll just run a bit of Alton. That's about the same thing, right?
Yeah, yeah, pretty much. The Foster's layout.
You reckon Alton's in next season? I don't know.
Yeah. Oh.
I don't know either. I actually don't know.
No, I don't know the tracks either. It's all a mystery.
It's all a mystery, even to me and you.
It is. We're coming up to the halfway mark now, so 34 minutes to go. Will we see some of the cars pit? I mean, going by the strats and the rest of the races, drivers preferring to pit late, isn't it? I think that's the favoured strategy.
Yeah, that seems to be how it is going right now.
Yeah. As we see the battle here, Rainer Schull still trying to catch Ben Lopard. We haven't seen much movement in the lap times, still within 5/10. Thibaut looks like he's just hanging back a little bit to catch up to Rainer Schull. I mean, by hanging back, you know, he's able to change his braking line a little bit, potentially gain up to Rainer Schull for a move behind. But yeah, these three drivers keeping a nice three-car train right now. Ben Lopard obviously doing a very good job defending as well. The Honda, as we mentioned before, is the favoured car here, I would say. But from what we're seeing right now, the Honda not having the easiest time getting around the other cars obviously comes down to a lot of the skill level as well. But yeah, that's what we're currently seeing. Thibaut just looking at a different line to Rainer Schull. He's within the sort of distance now where if Rainer does make a mistake, Thibaut is likely to be able to capitalize on it. So as long as he can stay within that gap, we may see another overtake coming in as well. As we swap over to David Cox, we can see he is in a tight little pack here with Jer in front and Sam. I think it's Sam.
Yeah.
If I'm wrong. Yeah, Sam Woodcave.
I think it's Sam. Yeah.
Yeah. With the Aston Martin. Now they are down in P14, 15, 16.
Stefan.
Yes, I thought I was wrong. I couldn't remember what it was. So yeah, even
it looks
though
like
they
Jaren
are down,
actually, David Cox are swapping positions.
Yeah, yeah. Again, the sand eating them up, isn't it?
Getting swallowed by the sandstorm. But yeah, a good little battle happening in 15th place right now. You know, Sam McCarthy also on the back of Fahair. You know, Fahair already leading that championship. So good sort of ability for Fahair to be able to, you know, pull away on the points, but just not able to capitalize on today's race. Does like the sand, apparently. But it doesn't seem to be getting him anywhere.
No, he might like the sand, but the car's not agreeing with him.
But yes, Thibaut in the pits early. Probably wants to get out of his. Probably wants to get out of that little battle he was in. Doesn't want to be involved any longer in that. Will be in the. It will still be in the battle for the race, but it'll be interesting to see how that number 77 pulls its way through this pack. Sam McCarthy still on the back of on Fahair, and I've been watching and monitoring the gap between Moomin and Averod. Now, a couple of laps ago, it's only 5/10 away. Now it's 1.5 seconds, so something's happened in the last few laps.
Ooh, interesting. So Averod putting his foot down then.
Mm-hmm.
Trying to get by. Could be because when we look at the standings, Ben Averod is technically behind Moomin right now. Only by, what is that, 5 points. So very, very close. And Moomin does have a missed round already. So Ben Averoad kind of has the advantage here. If he's able to keep that position, he's just, you know, that one step closer to securing P2 in the pro split. So, yeah, battles not only for positions here, but, you know, the overall point standings as well.
Yeah, that's exactly. I mean, we're seeing Moomin slowly start to drop off. I don't know whether it's, you know, apparently it might be because they have to overtake a back marker. But it seems like a big gap to start. And I mean, Moomin, you know, I can't see any other cars on track next to him right now. That is right now, and he's still dropping back a little bit. So yeah, I don't know whether the consistency is starting to come in play for Moomin. Jude Neville's still on the back of Pirello, though. The battle is still heating up for fifth place. Ben's 9 seconds ahead of Ben Averoad, though. I mean, you know, that's a big chunk.
Seconds, yeah. Yeah, next time he says that he's not, his car doesn't have a good balance on the track, I'm just going to call him a liar.
We'll just disregard any comment from Manuel Benz for the next
I'm absolutely happy to do that.
yeah, we'll just do that. Benz, you have no say.
You have no say. If you say a track's good, I'm going to think it's bad.
Yeah, we're going to not put it in. Actually, no, because if we tell him that now, he'll know. Dieter Santon looks like he's had an issue. In fact, the cameras can't even pick him up. Ah, there he is. Let's find out what happened to Dieter Santon as he came down into the... He's on his own here. Porsche things.
Yeah, it took quite a steep line into the corkscrew there. So yeah, I think he, as he just went over that left-hand curb, car got a little bit unsettled. Luckily managing to keep it out of the wall, so not, you know, could have been a lot worse there. Just needs to focus now. And keep it going. As we see, Moomin went into the pits for a sort of halfway pit point. Pit point, that's it. Oh yeah.
Pit point.
Pit point.
Is that what we're calling it now? Yeah, but coming out in 11th place position. So yeah, not too far down the grid, but we'll have to pick himself up the grid. Currently sat in 11th, like I said. Sam McCarthy in 8th, closing it down onto the back of Behar. You know, the number 8 car. Ooh, taking a very, very tight line through there. Trying to get as much gap onto the back of hair as he can. Taking a little bit too much of that. The sand, probably likely trying to make sure he slows down enough for the pit. Doesn't want to hit the wall. Doesn't. Good. Okay. And in. Jude Neville also in. Ben Lopez still out. The hair still out. And Moomin already done his pit and already onto the back of Johnny Ogden here.
Yeah, I think Jude Neville has got a fairly good chance at undercutting Ben Lopard. I mean, he managed to keep the times with him. As long as he had a perfect pit, you know, there's a good chance he might be able to pull it off. Question is Jude going to come out in traffic, though? Sorry, he's already come out. Looks like he's all okay. But yeah, Moomin... on the back of Johnny Ogden. Johnny does need to pit. Oh, sorry, as we see there, Jude coming out. Behind a Busso in the Busso, jank.
Yeah. Busso not pitting, though. So, you know, still in a race. Well, still not really in a race position with Busso. Stefan currently racing with Jair. Still Jair, you know, still in 11th. They both have to pit. Still in a race with each other. Dieter Santon down in 17th. Does have that 10-second penalty that will be applied at the end of the race by the looks of it, because he likely won't have to pit again. Fingers crossed and all that good shenanigans. But will Giron be able to get some time onto the back of Averoad by the time Averoad pits?
Yeah, he's going to need to try and get past Johnny Ogden in order to do that. Ogden not pitted yet, so on his first set of tyres. But, you know, also on some low fuel, so be interesting to see if he can get it by. Looking at the straight line speed, BMW not really gaining very much, is it? The slipstream by the McLaren doesn't seem to be that great, although he does manage to get down the inside, squeezing Johnny into the outside, letting him know he's there. Is he going to be able to keep it through the next corner? Ogden not letting him have it easy. Moomin losing out. I think Moomin thought that Johnny Ogden would give him that position, but no. Johnny Ogden saying, you're not having this one easy, sir. I'm taking that back.
Yeah, Moomin got in a little bit of a wiggly tail coming out of the back end of that corner, I think. So not being able to get past Johnny Ogden, but, you know, 3 temps away from Johnny Ogden right now. Still plenty of time to give this race some, but yeah, it's almost like Johnny Ogden and Ben Averrod are collaborating here.
Yeah, it is.
Just wants to hold him back a little bit. I mean, to be fair, you know, he's not going to give him the position, is he? Unless there's not much that Johnny Ogden can gain from it, because Johnny Ogden was already on the inside line there, so he was already on the quicker line. He's not going to randomly just slow down on the middle of the track to allow Giron pass. So yeah, you're probably going to see Giron have to at least battle a little bit for this position.
Yep, and that's why the pit strategy is so important. You know, you need to know where you're going to come out, because that's either going to help or slow you down. In this instance, you could say that it's maybe slowing Moomin down, but Johnny Ogden's in his every right. They're on the same lap. They're in the same class. You know, there's no reason that Johnny Ogden needs to let him by, so Moomin needs to put the effort in here. It's up to him to get it past, isn't it?
Yeah, that's it. I mean, you know, they're on the same fuel and same tyres. Pretty much the same, you know. Neither of them will switch tyres in the pits. Technically on the same strategy, technically in the same race, and like you said, in the same class. So yeah, Johnny Ogden's still going to defend, and this is the trade-off you get by going in early. If you go in at the middle way, you're going to definitely come out in traffic, and the question is, how nice is that traffic going to be?
As we see Jerome Moomin going for the inside line, Johnny Ogden moving over to the right. He's going to look for the switchback. Can he get it done? They're side by side, but he just takes it a little bit too wide. And it looks like Jerome Moomin, as we see the camera coming through the trees, manages to get it past. As we saw, which car was that? Just going
Doug Lee, it was.
Doug Lee, not having the as good of a time through the corkscrew. But yeah, Moomin finally managing to get it past. Johnny Ogden just lost out there, didn't he? Just going a little bit too wide on the exit of the corkscrew.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, you know, Johnny Ogden saw that coming. You're going to see that coming in at the corkscrew. And yeah, we saw it from Pirello. Same move. Just move it up the inside. And you don't want to be involved in an incident. So you might as well move out the way. Don't want to hurt your pit rep. You know, you don't have to get damage on your car for no reason. So even though you could kind of call it a dive, it's one of those that you kind of expect going in the corkscrew. So Johnny Ogden just conceding that position, doesn't really need to fight it. And yeah, definitely deciding that the safety is more important than defending off a move that he didn't need to defend off. Stefan Wuttke, though, right on the back of Jair Axlund, has been through a few laps, is racing him, is on the same strategy, is on the same lap. Stefan Wuttke going a little bit wide, though, really, really pushing at Aston around this track.
Yeah, he was very, very close there to Jez. He managed to get past because Jez just goes a little bit too wide. We've seen that quite a few times today, haven't we? And coming up fast behind is Doug Lee in the Aston. He's on the back of Jez. Jez's going to really need to get his foot down now. He's got to recover from that slight off track and get back focusing. Doug Lee very close behind as we see the onboard camera here. Coming through the second to last corner, Doug Lee managing to gain quite a bit of time. Yep, going into the pits. So yeah, lovely move there, and Doug Lee managing to I think there's some good racing there, even though it was only a couple of corners.
Yeah, interesting that Jair Axlund and Wuttke both coming into the pits at the same time, even though Wuttke's ahead. So it'll be interesting to see who gets out first, and it looks like Jair Axlund actually getting the better run, and I wonder why Wuttke stopped. Is he changing tires?
Is he?
No, that can't be a change.
Forgot to change his strap.
He wasn't stopped long enough. It looks like he's either had some damage he's fixing, or he's putting a little bit more fuel than Jair Axlund. So yeah, around about 10 seconds longer in the pits. And you're going to see that here when Jair Axlund starts to drive away. So all that gap that he's managed to close down, you know, he's going to be at least 10 seconds away from Jair right now.
Yeah, I'm intrigued to know what that is for. I can't figure it out.
Yeah, it's almost like he didn't really need to take that 10 second. I would have said that maybe it was stopping in the wrong place. But yeah, it won't be stopping in the wrong place, because that would only be a couple of seconds. And yeah, it's either do him more fuel, or he's decided to fix a bit of damage that he had, but I'm not really sure that, you know, the damage is really worth the 9 seconds that it's cost him between where Jair's come out and where Woodcase come out in 19th.
Yeah, I mean, if anyone in chat has any ideas, let us know. But yeah, I'm stumped. Be interesting to see if he lets us know in the Discord afterwards.
Yeah, it's one of those. It's an interesting one. Jude Neville, on the back of her hair still, you know. Daniel Benton still has the fastest lap. That hasn't changed since the quarter into the race. Benz is still holding that lap.
He is. I mean, Jude Neville, he's been stuck behind Verheer for quite a while now. Mm-hmm. He's not managed to find a place to get by. He's potentially happy with his position and, you know, just wanting to stick with Verheer, maybe not pushing too hard, or, you know, maybe Verheer is just driving really, really well that Jude Neville's not able to catch up. But I think the Ferrari... I didn't expect this, but the Ferrari doing pretty well here at Laguna.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a car that they, you know, they've obviously learned to stick with throughout the weeks, and I think when you get it sorted, it's definitely one of those that can give you consistent results. You know, it hasn't got the unpredictability of the Porsche sometimes. You know that Porsche can give you some unpredictable results in some races. And we're seeing here, you know, Jude Neville, 4 tenths away from Verheer, is able to keep it on the back of him. You know, Jude in that LT Racing has had some okay results. He's had some bad results as well. He's definitely got the pace to be able to close it down onto the Ferrari, and it'll be interesting to see if he can get some of that wrestled out of the Porsche here.
Yeah, if he's got the pace in the car, he just needs to get the his arms and legs working in unison to get that by. Just saw in the background there, Sam McCarthy being pressured by Dieter Santon as well. Two Porsches battling it out, trying to show us which one can go quicker. Dieter does have the 10-second penalty, though, so Sam McCarthy doesn't need to... I mean, he still needs to worry in the fact that, you know, he's still racing him, but with that 10-second gap, the pressure's a little bit off, isn't it? He's got a little bit of breathing space with that.
I mean, I'm not 100% sure. I mean, yes, in the fact that if Dieter Santon's ahead of him, yes, I would agree. But, yeah, on the back of him, I mean, you know, Dieter Santon's still a car. And he's definitely going to be looking to make Sam McCarthy's life not so easy. Oh, yeah, excellent. Finding a wall at the top of the corkscrew. At the top of the corkscrew. I'm not quite sure how he's managed that one. We'll find out. Has he just broke in the wrong spot? Yep, that... The Audi just deciding, actually, no, I'm going to engine brake a bit too much and kick me back end out on you.
I haven't seen that before, you know. I think that's the first time I've seen the car go to the right under braking up there.
Maybe that was the wrong button on the brake bias button, and it's just it's just decided that the wall is the better line through that track.
It turned it the wrong way.
Cruiser. I'm sure he knows it's all in good spirits. Right, Dieter Santon. Yeah, like we were saying. Right on the back of Sam McCarthy. I mean, he's not going to give that guy an easy life. That's all I can say. You know, Verheer currently on the back of Jude Neville. Jude's still holding on to 10th. Yeah, well, he's holding on to 10th. And he's dropped 3 positions from where he qualified. So down from 7th. Verheer up 3. And Doug Lee up 7 as well. But one man, still hasn't pitted with Doug Lee. Up 14 positions is Johnny Ogden. I mean, you know, he's still got that 10 seconds round trip in the pits or so. You know, with going through the pit lanes around about 30 seconds. So knocking back 30 seconds from where he is. And that's where his roundabout finishing position is. So quick maths, that's going to be around about 14th place right now as it stands. Question is that going to be where he's going to end up? Looking at Moomin, he's the top of the pitters. Benz hasn't pitted yet. So Ben's going long on the pits.
Ben does have a massive gap, though.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, Ben's a 15-second gap on Everard, so... Even, I wonder if Ben's trying to go for the, even if I do pit, I'm not going to be behind you anyways.
Yeah.
Strat.
Once I get enough gap that I can pit for free, I'll pit.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's like F1 was saying, the pit window is now open for the safety car. The Benz is going to go for the gap window is now open for me to actually not lose position when I pit. So, yeah, it'll be interesting.
Someone who has done incredibly well, Cabrera, still in P3. You know, silver driver, new to the championship. This is his second race in this championship. He's obviously raced with us. And does take part in our Saturday league as well. Cough, cough, if you want to be racing in the league on Saturday, we do also do that. But yeah, fantastic race from Cabrera. Really showing us that, you know, maybe he should be in that pro split next season.
I mean, yeah, if we're looking at it right, Cabrera, like you're saying, in third place position right now. I mean, he's got 1.5k pit skill. I mean, that will all change next season, of course. But, you know, basing that on the rest of the grid, pretty high up the grid in terms of pit skill ratings.
Yeah, I believe. He's definitely putting that to work, isn't he, in these races?
and I think we'll likely see him move up into pros next season. You know, it depends on how it rates him at the end of this season. But, yeah, I reckon, you know, getting involved in multiple races a week is definitely the way to go. Get involved in as many races as you can, because the 20-minute races do as much for your pit skill as the one-hour races, because at the end of the day, you're still beating the same drivers on the same track. I mean, no, you're not expecting to gain any less for beating the same drivers on a shorter race, because technically, it's harder to beat a faster driver on a shorter race. Technically. I mean, they're both the same, to be honest. You know, you're still going to do the same lap times, so...
Yeah.
At the end of the day, the idea is to get involved in as many races as possible so that your rating can get the quickest amount of changes as possible, and then you can get yourself in the right class, and that's the whole point of the system. So yeah, we always recommend to everyone to get involved in as many races as Sam McCarthy just squeezing it up the inside of her hair there. Will he finally get that ninth place position back? Yes, he does.
Does he?
Does he? Fahera. Getting himself a little claws down there. Let's see that from TV cam. You could just see Fahera already on the switchback, trying to get himself up the inside. It wasn't really left the room up the inside, though. And yeah, a little contact coming between the two, but neither car really missing out. In fact, Sam McCarthy managing to get himself up in at ninth place, and Fahera down to 10th place there.
Yeah, that was a frisky move, wasn't it? That's all I'll say on that one. But now Fahair has got the pressure from behind as well. As we see the three cars here coming down the corkscrew. The Porsche of Dieter Santon now behind. Is he going to be able to catch up? We've seen one Porsche overtake this Ferrari. Can a second Porsche overtake the sandbank?
I mean, Dieter Santon still has that 10-second penalty, but what we said earlier, you know, it doesn't really matter.
That camera angle made it look like a very late break. Well, I think it's just a camera angle.
it's that whole concertina effect, right? Yeah, but yes, Dieter Santon, you know, he already has that 10 seconds of penalty, but will be looking to make up as many positions as he can to offset that penalty, because he doesn't want to drip down any more than he already is. So yeah, currently in 11th, you know, has Bussell GT 12 seconds behind. Obviously Bussell still has to pit, and then Johnny Ogden 5 seconds behind that. So technically right now won't lose any positions, but can still gain some.
Yes, yeah, definitely can. Did I just see Manuel Benz in the rearview mirror of Dieter Santon? I think I did.
You did, yes. That is Benz in the... can we see it there? Can we see it through the rearview mirror? Let's find out. There he is.
There we go.
With a nice bit of a pit skill wing advertisement there.
There we go. But that just shows Manuel Benz has lapped everyone. Well, he hasn't pitted, but technically... he has lapped back up to 12th place.
You know how we were saying his pit's nearly free? Well, in 5 seconds, he will be ahead 5 seconds of... well, if he was 5 seconds ahead further down the road, he would be 5 seconds ahead of current second place Cabrera. So, could do. Could still get a free pit. I mean, he won't get it to Ben Averod, but he could still get one to Cabrera. So, possible. Dieter Santon, still on the back of Fajerno.
Yeah, definitely. I think he's got a taste now. He can smell the overtake. Yeah, as soon as Sam McCarthy got it past for her, Dieter Santon's now the next one in line. And if one Porsche can do it, there's no reason that a second Porsche can't as well. So, yeah, he'll be looking for that overtake. But, you know, what's he going to do in terms of Manuel Benz behind? Is he going to have to lose time letting him by? Is he going to be lucky and, you know, is the blue flag going to come at a place where it's nice and easy? It could come into effect here.
Yeah, I mean, that's the question, right? We've seen the EU1 sim spot number 2 right on the back of her, but Manuel Benz is going to have to lap him at some point, and lap him he will. I can tell you, in the next 10 minutes, Benz will get past Dieter Santon, or he'll pit. Who knows? We're definitely going to find out, but Dieter Santon right on the back of Behar. It's close. I mean, you know, he loves the sand. Does the sand love him? Will he end up in the sand, or will he just, you know, manage to keep the Dieter Santon away for 9 minutes? Hey, Glovebot. Yeah. Welcome to the stream, dude. Nice to see you in the stream. I've shared a booth with Glovebot in the ADAC commentary, so it's nice to see him. Nice to see him in our little world.
In our little world of pit skill, indeed. looking just up and down the grid, I can see Chris Wright has got Rainer Schull for company. And by company, I mean battley, it looks like, looking at the split.
Yeah, I mean, you know, Rainer Schull right on the back of Chris Wright. We're seeing the Hondas start to come in. Jordan Bailey right on the back of Rywell. It looks like Rywell has managed to pull back some of that loss at the start of the race. Still getting himself into a good race. With Jordan Bailey, who's also down there in 21st. Jordan Bailey not having the best of races either. I mean, we saw him maybe not qualify the best either at, if I remember rightly. This is where I'm going to shoot myself in the foot. Yeah, I mean, qualified 11th. Not the best for Jordan Bailey. Definitely capable of faster times. Just not being able to get it together. And I think he only got a couple of valid laps in that BMW. So, yeah, Jordan Bailey still having a great race for Ryan Weller, though. You know, just shows that, you know, sticking around to the end of the race does still reap its benefits as well, as long as you're not getting in there. And you can still pick up some points, possibly.
You can, yeah, especially with the class points. Mm-hmm. Guess who's pitted?
Has Ben's finally come into the pits? Yes, he has.
He's finally decided it was time to come into the pits, and it looks like a very quick pit as well. I was looking at the track map, and he'd only just stopped, so let's see where he's going to come out. Place your bets, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, here's Averod, who was second behind him. Will Averod come out behind Benz? Well, he definitely will, definitely.
Yeah, he's miles behind, isn't he? He's absolutely miles.
Yeah, it's interesting. I mean, I was going to say, will he come out behind? But he's already pitted anyway. So I was trying to figure out if it was going to be a free pit for Benz. But it technically is anyway. So, I mean, he was well ahead. But yes, 15 seconds the difference between the two now. Dieter Santon, still on the back of her. 6 minutes to go. The question is, who's going to come out ahead of these two drivers? Santon already has a 10-second penalty, so already involved in one incident. Busso GT, no, he's enjoying himself a little bit of a open track here.
He is. Still does need to pit. Hopefully he's not forgot. I'm sure he hasn't. with the roaring engine of the Jaguar, able to coast around this track nice and open right now. I mean, if we were to predict, I mean, here we go. He's into the pits. There's no point predicting. We'll know in a second where he's going to come out.
It is nice to see the old Jag out on the track. And someone who isn't out on the track is Rainer Schull, who was parked very predicamently there. Luckily, we don't have to get a Torware to come and... Ah, Jordan Bailey. Everyone else avoided him apart from Jordan Bailey, who managed to somehow run into the side of him. I think he was trying to find a way around... Roy Weller there, but yeah, a little bit of a slapperoonie on the side there. Won't help Jordan Bailey's race, really. But Rainer Schull dropping down because he didn't want to cause any further incidents there. But he's bunched up the pack a little bit because, you know, Chris Wright right on the back of... I didn't mean to say Wright, by the way, then. But right on at the back of Johnny Ogden. Data Santon still on the back of Fahair. Doug Lee getting himself into a free car race here. I mean, technically the car behind him isn't racing him because it's Manuel Benz. It's more like trying to hot lap past him. But Doug Lee trying to get himself past Cox here. Late on the brakes. That was late on the brakes, that one, Harrison.
That was. I could tell that one.
You could tell that one. But yes, Doug Lee trying to find any move he can find past David Cox in the next 5 minutes.
Yes, yeah, he's going to need to push now. The BMW looks to be struggling a little bit here at Laguna, from what I've seen a little bit further down the grid. So the Aston Martin and Doug Lee might be able to catch. But he's going to have Manuel Benz coming up fast behind here. So he's going to need to look for a place to let Manuel Benz by while also not losing much time. Can he do it? I mean, we'll see here in a second as they come round.
Yeah, I mean, you can see Doug Lee does close down the gap onto David Cox. I mean, it's likely that the tighter lines, you can see him just he's letting off the throttle a little bit, just balancing the car through the corners. Benz might be his sort of pass past David Cox, though, because if he allows Benz past, kind of, doesn't want to lose out on any speed, obviously, but knows that Benz is quick anyways. Oh, actually, Benz is going to go, yeah, I'm going to sit the inside line here. Probably not where Doug Lee wanted him to take the inside line. No. Has lost out on quite a bit of time to David Cox ahead, but if Benz makes David Cox do a similar line, you know, could allow for Doug Lee to close down that gap.
It could. Is he going to be able to capitalize on it, though? We will find out soon, because Benz is catching up quickly to David Cox. David Cox going a little bit wide there onto the sand as we come around the final corner. If Benz gets a good final corner here, he may have a chance down into the first couple of corners. He just looks a little bit too far behind, actually. I reckon we might see it later on in the track.
I mean, I know it's Benz and all, but I don't think he's going to send it from a whole 7/10 back, really, yeah.
You know what? I wouldn't put it past him.
I mean, if you think he could stop the car in time, I think he probably would. But, you know, not wanting to risk his race, but will be looking for a move past David Cox pretty quickly, because you can see he's catching him quick.
Yeah, he's managed to scrub, what's that, 5/10 in the space of a couple of corners?
Yeah, pretty much. There you go, finding that move up the inside.
There we go.
Much more favourable for David Cox, that one, than it was for Doug Lee on the previous lap, though. But Doug Lee now back on the back of David Cox. Ahead, however, Chris Wright is literally puffing exhaust fumes from Johnny Ogden on that McLaren right now.
He is, and I know from his recent YouTube videos... for those that don't know, his YouTube channel SimQuip, which is in the team name down the bottom right. His battles have been getting closer and closer since he's joined the championship. So yeah, this is one driver that has definitely improved, and you can see the accumulation of all his experience and gains in this championship happening right here with the closeness of this battle. As he looks for the inside line down into turn one, he's keeping it safe. Is Ogden going to let him by? Jonathan Ogden didn't let Moorman get this line. But yeah, Chris manages to make it stick. What a beautiful overtake there from Chris.
Does that mean Chris is better than Jerome?
I think Chris would say yes. Chris would take that one.
We'll wait until the YouTube video comes out, won't we?
Is this where we get a clip of our voices in his video?
Let's find out. Right, is Jair Axlin currently in 17th then, behind Woodke? Woodke actually having a good old battle with Jair while that fight was going on. Imagine to get himself up into 16th. Now, Woodke doing a good... I remember him joining the championship. He didn't have the greatest starts to the championship, but... ever since around about the halfway mark, I'd say he's definitely started to improve that sort of positioning that he's getting himself into. So, you know, definitely getting himself improved, and it's great to see drivers improve. And it looks like Reina Shaw behind has actually picked up a drive-through penalty or track limit. So Jordan Bailey, you know, doesn't have to really worry about Reina Shaw anymore, but might be able to get a few more positions onto the back of Roy Weller. The man who has started at the final lap, though, has Manuel Benz. And apparently, car 7 is unsafe rejoin causing a collision. Don't know what penalty he got, though. I'm sure the stewards will sort that one out.
Hey, did the drive-through come from the stewards?
That might be it. I thought it was for track limits, but it might be from the unsafe rejoin.
Interesting. Drive-through was from stewards. It was. Interesting, last minute penalty coming in.
There you go.
A last minute move. Ike Chew's in the Mercedes, looking to get it past the jag of Busso, but Busso not letting that happen easily, especially on the final lap. But the Mercedes doesn't care. It's going to try and stick on the back. It's going to use the slipstream as we come round the fast right-hander. Has the Mercedes got the runner on Busso?
It's interesting to see the jag doing okay, actually. It's nice to see the jag doing okay. I mean, it's still, you know, still at the bottom of the grid, technically. It's only gained 5 positions from where it qualified, which was one is from the driver no longer being here. But the other 4, I think Ike's had issues, Nige had issues, and Fredrickson definitely had issues losing out 12 positions. But you can see that. Oh, and Benz has finished the race. We're still doing that wrong, Harrison.
we're still missing.
we're
good at this. Professional streamers.
David Cox also finishing the race ahead of Doug Lee. And because he's teleported back to the pits, it messes everything up. Woodke also in 16th. Jair Axlin 17th. Roy Weller 18th. Jordan Bailey 19th. Fredrickson crossed the line in 24th. Ben Averrod 2nd, rather. Cabrera does finish in the top 5 then, ladies and gentlemen. Giron in 4th. Pirello and Thibaut battling it out for 5th and 6th. Lopard and I believe that was... not Axlin. I think it was Nige in 23rd there. Jude Neville in 8th. I wish everyone would just stay on the track. That'd be really easy for me to zip through everyone. Ferrer in 10th. Theatre Santon in 11th. David Cox in 14th. Doug Lee 15th. Then Woodke does get himself in 16th. And Chris Wright in 17th. But I'm seeing 2 17th places. 18th apparently. What is going on with this grid?
What?
Have you seen that? It's just zipping up and down.
According to the in-game one, he finishes P12.
Yeah, he does finish P12.
Yeah, there we go.
Just because people leaving and joining and all that kind of cool jazz. Chris Wright in 12th and Johnny Ogden finishing in 13th in the end then. So that is your result, ladies and gentlemen. And if people would stay in the race, they did it well last week.
They did.
And then the oldest decide, actually, I've had enough Laguna Circuit. Can we go on now? But yes, Benz finishing the race. 15 seconds ahead of Averrod in the end. And Cabrera in 3rd. So Cabrera, if you voted Corpium, if you believed, then you are picking up yourself some points. And tell you what, most people didn't. Most people didn't believe. They didn't believe. If only they had believed. So if you were here from the start and you believed, then you have picked up some points for Cabrera finishing in the top 10. But yeah, if you didn't watch the start of the stream in the qualifying in the silvers, you might want to go and watch it. Might want to go and watch it. Spoilers alert. But there you go then. Cabrera taking out the silvers. Jude Neville in second and Sam McCarthy in third. For Hare, who was actually first in the silvers, finishing fourth in the end. So, yeah, it'll be interesting to see how they shape the points next week.
Yes. And I don't think the excitement for this evening is over yet. We still need to see what is going to happen with the points. As soon as this race gets rated, we're going to start to see those drop rounds come in. I can't wait for that announcement, Terry. I can't wait for the bot to say this event has now been rated because, I need to know what's going to happen with the standings.
Yeah, that's it. We just need to see who drops what round and how the points lay out, because right now, like I said, every single round is counted. So, it'll be interesting to see how that... Want to do a driver of the day? Yeah, we could do a driver of the day. Right, driver of the day. There we go. Slap it on. Yeah, there you go.
We can vote driver of the day every week.
We definitely don't forget, because we don't forget to click the first place position either. But there you go then, ladies and gentlemen. Click, don't click. Hashtag any driver number if you wish to vote for a driver of the day. Anyone can pick anyone. And you can get yourself... I don't know, some e-friends from voting for them. But do not forget to come back next week for the finale. The finale. The finale that we'll be heading. Where will we be heading, Harrison?
To good old Kyle Army.
Yes, that's right. We'll be heading to Kyle Army for the final round of Season 16. Under the current setup on Pitskill. That's right. We will be heading to Kyle Army for the final of Season 16 and the final of Pitskill 1.0. Wow. That's
indeed. It's not only the end of the season, it's the end of an era.
The end of a chapter.
At first I thought I was over-exaggerated, but the more I think about it, it is kind of a fresh start, isn't it?
Yeah, it is. I mean, we're still bringing over a year's worth of data, but yeah. Yeah, it's gonna be emotional. It's gonna be an emotional day next week. So make sure you tune into the stream. Maybe we'll have 5,000 signups on the website by then.
Maybe. I mean, if people watching go and sign up, yeah, they'll help us get towards that.
I'll go and tell others to sign up, you know. 5,000 signups. Who knows? Who knows? But yes, driver today looks like it's going to number 16. Looks like it's going to number 16 so far. Cabrera for taking home top of the silvers. Thanks to all the new followers, by the way. Thanks to everyone who's dropped in the chat for the first time. We'll be here again next week for the GT3 World Challenge Trophy for the finale. See who wins it. Will Manuel Benz be able to take home the win? I mean, he could do. He's still got the drop rounds to come into effect, though. So we'll find out what happens with them, as we said, when this race gets there. Race gets its results done. But Kyle Army next week and all to play for. Same day, same time, 7 p.m. UTC on Wednesday here on the Pit Crew TV or the Pitskill.io GT3 World Challenge. Thanks to everyone that's tuned in, and we will see you again next week. And congratulations. Clocks change. They're still UTC. Still 7 p.m. UTC. But yes.
Yeah, you just got to convert UTC to
whatever.
Summertime.
Whatever.
Is it,
yeah.
Is it summertime? Whatever. Whatever England does. I don't know what
England
does.
Isn't it like a week later? An hour later? I don't know.
A week later?
Yeah, it's a week later. No, it's just next week, 7 p.m. UTC. Go and convert it.
Google is your friend.
Google is your friend, yes. And the number 16 car picking up the driver today. So congratulations to the 16. And we will see you again next week.